Hi, it's March 19th, 2017. This is the new installment of the William J. and Hillary R. Clinton Presidential Penitentiary Library on Bold Like a Leopard Network. It's one of the projects I'm doing. You know, I haven't done one for a while, and this one's a rehash. I did a small general video at the beginning, but I'm doing individual ones for each book. And this is the latest one. It's called Crisis of Character by Gary Byrne. And Gary Byrne was an officer of the Secret Service Uniform Division. For those of you who don't know, the United States Secret Service has a number of divisions. Okay, they don't just protect the President of the United States. They also have a division that's under the entire service is under the U.S. Treasury Department. That's something that people don't often realize, that the Secret Service is working for the United States Treasury, just like the IRS has its own enforcement wing. The Secret Service is actually also part of the Treasury Department. You have the ATF, which is part of the Department of Justice, the U.S. Marshals, which is part of the Department of Justice, the FBI, which is part of the Department of Justice. They all have their own tactical teams and things like that. But the Uniform Division is almost like the police service for the White House in this case. They have other areas where they serve. Often they'll serve in federal buildings as the police there, because technically local police aren't allowed to enforce the laws within a federal building. They can cooperate with them, and there's protocols for that, but they're not really allowed to be the law enforcement service in these federal properties. So you have the Secret Service doing that. Most people know of more the Secret Service agents, the personal protective detail, PPD, and those are the people that they protect VIPs, including former President Bush and Obama, and former President Clinton, and of course the current president. They also protect a lot of the cabinet officials, and in Gary Byrne's case, he came into the service under President George Bush the first, George H.W. Bush. And his account of that period was that the Bushes were some of the more nice people that he's met. Certainly they were old school, but they didn't really have the type of attitude that they were entitled to anything at the White House as far as the Secret Service were concerned. And he kind of makes it seem like George Bush was the nicest person you can meet. I kind of tend to think that that's a little simplistic. Maybe he was nice in person, but I don't think that George Bush, just because he was such a nice person, that's really a reason to support one or the other. I mean, they say that his son, George Bush Jr., was also a really nice guy, but in the end, you have to support officials based on their policies as opposed to their personality. That's just my opinion. I think Barack Obama had a great personality. That doesn't mean I supported him. So let's talk about a few of the details that Byrne highlights in the book. It concerns mainly his work in the Secret Service as a part of the protective envelope that was surrounding Bill Clinton. So what you should know is that the uniform division, the UD, SSUD, is different from the attached agents, the ones that are protecting the president at all times, his personal detail. They follow him around. They're the ones in the suits with the earpieces. It's a much different function. The uniform division, for example, when people come into the Oval Office, they have to go through them. When people come into the White House itself, they have to go through them. They're the ones who are conducting the security checks, not the agents, not the protective detail. Those people have to have their hands free at all times. And in fact, Byrne actually goes in and he details that a lot of the services, the security services in the federal level have some tension between them, including within the Secret Service, between the uniformed division and the suits, the ones that are the protective detail. And he also says a lot of times that the FBI has a lot of tension with the Secret Service. They don't trust each other. It's a question of who leaks what and who's responsible for what. It's typical office politics in some ways. One of the things that he talks about is that immediately the character of the White House changed once the Clintons took power. And here's one. So he's told that he's supposed to go, it was on the day of or a couple days after the Clintons got inducted into the White House, inaugurated. And he says this: many staffers were stalwart professionals. Some sprouted massive egos upon stepping through the White House door. This is on page 45. I was on break when I heard a call over the radio. Bandbox to any available West Wing officer. Byrne here. Byrne, proceed to the pool and check on an unidentified male in the pool. Someone needs to go check this guy out immediately. Byrne, copy, I said as I jogged over. The First Family has its own private pool. Once when First Lady Bush swam, there were a rat. Let's skip over this part because it's just useless crap. But an unknown man in a suit and tie had his feet in the pool, his hands rolled up as if he were on vacation. He was always looking. He was looking around, la-di-da, and kicking his bare feet, leaning back and gawking at the sky. Hey, how you doing? I asked, sort of sincerely curious. He looked at me bright-eyed. Isn't this great? Sure is, I humored him. We made it. We did it, he said, astonished by his own success. We're going to change everything. He talked and talked. Some of these new Clinton hires were really something. Mind if I see your pass? I interrupted. It was in his desk, he told me. I asked his name, and he told me we could be friends. But when I radioed Bandbox to check his name, the man's tone changed. He waved me off, saying he didn't need a pass. I informed him he did. He responded, we run the place now. You're going to have to get used to that. I responded with a flat, yeah, no. My colleagues arrived, and his feet left the pool. He blustered that we had it in for him, launching into a do-you-know-who-I-am routine. He never got his White House pass back. Good riddance. Okay, so they fired that guy. Then he talks about these gay guys that come up to him, and they started like provoking him and saying, you know, they had these Mardi Gras beads and whatever, and they were asking if he had any problem with that. He says that he had a gay roommate in the Air Force, so you know that was like an interesting take on the White House people coming in, the new Clinton people. Then there's an incident where he hears over the radio. Next, I heard over the radio, officers have just apprehended a staffer trying to enter with a pistol. That sock had a Glock pistol in it. The District of Columbia ranks among the nation's most anti-gun locations in the country, and this new staffer was blatantly committing dozens of gun-related felonies just by possessing a handgun. He was fired, arrested, and prosecuted. He basically told UD that the rules didn't apply to him. Idiot, but it takes one to hire one. I was learning this incident was especially incredible, knowing the Clintons' anti-Second Amendment sentiment. So, you know, just like he says, the Clintons had people coming in, you know, and the Second Amendment case, the guy with the Glock, that's an excellent case in point. You're not allowed to. I don't think even the most pro-gun person would argue that you should be able to enter the White House, whatever job you are, with your own personal handgun. You know, there. First of all, there's so many people there. There could be VIPs coming from overseas that you know, they need to be protected too. It's not just about the President of the United States. So this is an area where the Second Amendment is irrelevant. This is. The security requirements of the office of the president. And as for the person in the pool, you know, that's something that they you hear a lot of, not just with this book. This is Gary Byrne. There's another book I read a few weeks ago called Unlimited Access by Gary Aldridge. And they all talk about how the Clinton people, they came into the White House with an entitlement. They believed that they were the new revolutionaries coming in, and that everything must be done to accommodate them, especially concerning whether they could be cleared for coming in and getting security passes. And it caused great strife within the Secret Service and the FBI. They sort of found that their security procedures were ignored entirely. So let's talk about the next problem. Okay, so here's a couple examples of, well, here's one example of those security lapses. So one of the things that happened was that the Clintons' political aides objected when the Secret Service wanted to screen people and check them and verify that they were unarmed and whatever during the engagements with the Clintons. And it happened that these frictions often came to, you know, they came to a head. And here's one where downstairs in the lobby, the staffer swore to the agent that she knew each person, but he insisted on verifying each visitor. She pressured him and he trusted her. Upstairs, people entered completely unscreened. No metal detection, no ID checking, nothing. One guy rushed up, right up to President Clinton, gave him a hearty handshake and exclaimed that he was his biggest fan. Clinton asked who he was, but nobody knew. The agents rushed him out. The staffer responsible for this fiasco turned to the agent and, to her credit, surrendered her radio ID and credentials, resigning immediately. Wrapped up in the president's schedule, she had left his life completely in God's hands, taking it out of the services. So I think that might be an exaggeration, but first of all, it would be better if he would at least mention names. You know, if he took notes, he would probably have taken her name. And that's something that he did in a lot of the cases in this book. I'm wondering why he didn't do it that time. Another thing that he says is that the Clintons wanted us to be user-friendly, which translated into, do what we tell you when we tell you to do it. They wanted us to look unintimidating. Appearances really came to a head on Mrs. Clinton's detail. Eventually, personnel assigned to it regarded the honor as a punishment. It was a transfer no one wanted because of its a constant stress and negativity. Then here comes a case where he details how the Clintons actually formulated a lot of their actions, a lot of their courses of action, and this concerns Somalia. He says, page 51, I vividly remember Secretary of State Les Aspin, George Stephanopoulos, who was the president's communications director, I think. He now works for ABC as a journalist. Advisor Rahm Emanuel, now the mayor of Chicago, and others convening about an operation in Mogadishu, the Somali capital. Though all of this was way over my pay grade, I couldn't believe what I was hearing. The three walked outside the Roosevelt Room into the hallway in front of me at my Oval Office post to reiterate what they had just discussed. They don't need tanks, Stephanopoulos insisted, as if the request was absurd and excessive. Yeah, they don't need, they agreed, listing the military's supposedly excessive requests for AC-130 gunships, armored personnel carriers, and other equipment. We don't want to look too militant, someone said. I was stunned. How does the military look too militant? It was bizarre. Somewhere in the chain of command, the decision was purely political. They agreed based on branding, and they were meddling heavily with the military. I knew from my Air Force days that no one would even see an AC-130 gunship in the sky. It'd be too high. I had no idea what caused their resistance to armored personnel carriers, or if some even knew the difference between an APC and a tank. Their nonchalance in regarding a military request made me very uneasy. Yeah, there's no reason for that, they kept reaffirming. It's just a simple in and out. Meanwhile, President Clinton was riding and still rides in an armored limousine that rivaled any APC. It just enjoyed the federal funding to make it look like a Cadillac. So then another problem here is that the Clintons wanted to undertake a mission in Somalia. Somalia, for those of you that don't know, descended into chaos in the early 90s. Its government fell apart. It had had like a socialist leadership that just completely collapsed. And in 1993, I believe, the Clintons decided that the United States would become involved through a UN mission in Somalia. I think it was called UNISOM or something, or that would be ironic, because isn't UNISOM some sort of medication for amnesia, for not amnesia, for insomnia? It was actually called UNITAF, and it operated for about 6 months. Under President Bush, it started. So you could say it wasn't necessarily President Clinton's fault, but in the end, he did lose the mission, and it could have easily been won if they would have given it the proper proper technical backing, which included a lot of the equipment that they were talking about, that Gary Byrne was talking about. And it says here, page 53, it says, "Years later, I realized why this always bothered me so. The Clinton leadership style had conflicting ideologies. They wanted to help but never hurt, like a doctor wanting to heal but never use a scalpel or draw blood. He misses both goals abysmally." Another thing that he discusses is the arrogance of Hillary Clinton. Now, when Hillary Clinton came to the White House, she, and this is discussed by both Gary Byrne and Gary Aldrich and Barbara Olson and a lot of the other Clinton biographers, Dick Morris, you could say that that all of them had a consistent thread here, that Hillary Clinton did not want to be limited the way the other first ladies had before. She was a complete social justice warrior in that respect. You know, the way, even though I hate using that term, it just comes to mind so often. She wanted to say, you know, it doesn't matter that I don't have any elective office. I have no official right to be involved in anything. I want to be just as involved as President Clinton because for some reason, I'm more qualified than any of the other first ladies were before. You know, it doesn't matter that some of these first ladies that came before her were, you know, pretty well, actually, I think it was called UNISOM. Sorry about that. But it's UNOSOM instead of UNISOM. But sorry about that. That's a little tangent there about Somalia. President Clinton or First Lady Clinton, she had this inferiority complex her entire life, that she was always claiming that people were discounting her because she was a woman. Meanwhile, they were doing things all the time, like appointing a attorney general just based on the fact that she was a woman. That was Janet Reno. Janet Reno was otherwise not very qualified. She was actually a pretty bad prosecutor in Florida. So what does Gary Byrne have to say about that? It says, "What she and her staffers failed to realize was that the White House had a budget like any other government entity. Each syndic had to be paid either from the executive residence budget or the Democratic Party's purse. Event planners dropped the ball on costs. One Rose Garden event required big rented air-conditioned tents that ruined the lawn. Landscaping crews and the National Park Service tore up all the dead grass, installed new sod, and sent them the bill. That's expensive, but you can't just have a whole White House lawn muddy and looking like crap. Just get it done," the staffers would say. Then there's other things. There's George Stephanopoulos himself agreed sometimes. Here's another small case before I get to George Stephanopoulos. It says the vice president's residence. So there was a case where the Clintons made the entire White House get rewired because they thought that the phone system was getting tapped by President Bush. Interesting for our times, because they're saying it's so ridiculous that Donald Trump thinks that Barack Obama tapped him. Yet President Clinton was, and his especially Hillary Clinton, the Clintons truly, truly believe that George Bush was tapping them. And they actually reinstalled the phone system in the White House. Now, it says here the vice president's residence is at the Naval Observatory on Massachusetts Avenue, a few blocks from the White House. Technicians at the control center of the technical service were surprised to see alarms going off at the house. First carbon monoxide, then heat alarms, then other alarms, even the radiation alarm. Something was seriously amiss. SAs, that's secret, that's Secret Service agents and UD officers immediately responded, letting themselves in. They found Vice President Al Gore standing on a chair, pulling an alarm out of the ceiling, looking for hidden cameras and listening devices. So there's all these cases where they don't trust anybody. They don't take no for an answer. And George Stephanopoulos he was always talking about how the Clintons were angry at him, and they were just a pile of rage. And he says in this quote, it says, "When Hillary was angry, you didn't always know it right away. A calculated chill would descend over time. Bill Clinton's anger was a more impersonal physical force, like a tornado. The tantrum would form in an instant and exhaust itself in a violent rush. Whoever happened to be in the way would have to deal with it. More often than not, that person was me." So that's George Stephanopoulos whining about him being the target of Bill Clinton's anger. Maybe because Bill Clinton was such a fucking liar and George Stephanopoulos couldn't cover for him. That might be a reason. "While I often saw the president fume," this is Gary Byrne again, "I rarely saw him become irate. Meanwhile, I often saw, heard about the First Lady's volcanic eruptions at UD officers, Secret Service agents, especially on her own detail, and all the people who worked at the White House. I laughed at Stephanopoulos' take because it seemed we witnessed opposite things. While the president must have vented his frustrations to the staff, Mrs. Clinton vented on everyone, and it got worse the more at home she felt in the White House. Most of us knew to brace for her inevitable eruptions. They didn't happen every day, but behind closed doors, we learned about them fast. In public, she was everyone's best friend. Privately, she was her normal self. And it was early September 1995. I had seen the news like everyone else. The night before, a Metro police officer had alleged that George Stephanopoulos was in the midst of a hit and run when the officer stopped him and administered a breathalyzer test for alcohol. George's car was usually parked on West Executive for weeks at a time, it seemed, but he hardly drove. It had dings all around and a busted taillight." Anyway, it goes on to say that George Stephanopoulos, he had this hit and run incident, and he claimed that it was the cops who they just busted his ass because he happened to pull out too straight. What actually happened was that he did hit another car and he ran away. So, you know, that's the type of people that the Clintons had, all these idiots that they couldn't take responsibility for their own mistakes. And that was just his communication staff. Here on page 66, Byrne talks about Vince Foster, who was Hillary's supposed lover, some would say. She was his partner at the Rose Law Firm in Arkansas, in Little Rock. And he was believed to have committed suicide. It was alleged that the official story is that he committed suicide in 1993. There's many theories that he was actually murdered because of what he knew about Whitewater. And it says here, "I mostly saw," page 66, "I mostly saw Vince Foster in the hallways. He was Mrs. Clinton's personal attaché, a lawyer from Arkansas. Word circulated that she berated him mercilessly. The first time I saw Foster, I figured he wouldn't last a year. He looked uncomfortable and unhappy in the White House. I knew what it was like to be yelled at by superiors, but Mrs. Clinton never hesitated to launch a tirade. Yet her staffers never dared say, 'I don't have to take this shit.' They reminded me of battered wives, too loyal, too unwilling to acknowledge they'd never assuage her. They had no one to blame but themselves, but they could never admit it." Then it says, "A UD friend of mine, Hank O'Neill, was posted outside of Foster's office as part of the FBI's investigation of his suicide. Maggie Williams, Mrs. Clinton's always well-dressed chief of staff, physically pushed her way past Hank into Foster's office, arguing that he had no right to block her entrance. She removed boxes that were never recovered. They were destroyed. Congressman bashed Officer O'Neill's integrity, but he held firm. He reported exactly what he saw and didn't make any inferences about it. But they were sure he held some smoking guns and was protecting the Clintons." Anyway, there was he also talks about his friendship with Gary Aldrich, the FBI guy, a guy who later turned out to be a huge Clinton critic, who said, "I keep having to tell them," he confided in us, "we're not your private investigative service over here, we're the FBI." Okay, so that came into relevance. Later, the Clintons would use FBI files after Aldrich left in order to try to spy on their political opponents. Okay, another thing that most people know is that the Clintons were notorious for lying about, everything. But one of the things that people wondered was whether Hillary Clinton knew about her husband's affairs. And one of the things that Gary Byrne talks about, Gary Aldrich too, is that President Clinton was doing everything he could to make sure that Hillary Clinton didn't walk in on him fucking somebody else. But he was always leaving it to the Secret Service to take care of that. Here's one example. He says on page 112, "And we have had more to worry about than even Monica. I worked the evening shift during a Christmas season. The president was in the map room. I'd grabbed some food in the east wing and was headed back to the west wing. A PPD friend and I shot the breeze. A Navy steward pushed the map room door open with his butt. In retrospect, we might have advised him to knock first. We didn't. There before us was E! Network host Eleanor Mondale, former Vice President Walter Mondale's daughter and President Clinton in a compromising position, that is, making out on the map room table. The steward hurriedly put his head down and departed. The doors closed. Am I the only one who saw that?" I asked. I wasn't. I clearly wasn't. So here's President Clinton, fucking the former vice president's daughter in the White House, and he doesn't care that anybody could walk in at any moment. There's other cases where, he says that Monica Lewinsky was trying to get into the White House all the time and she wouldn't take no for an answer, and she was even putting herself in danger if Hillary Clinton would have walked by. There would have clearly been a case where there would have been like some sort of bitch fight in the White House. And then the other thing is that he was able to show, at least according to his own witness experience, that Monica Lewinsky wasn't nearly the only problem with Clinton banging people in the White House, banging these chicks. He has this case where this Navy steward on page 114 brings to him these towels with a presidential seal on them, and they have jizz stains on them with lipstick. And if there's jizz stains and lipstick, that's because he was getting a blowy from some chick. And he says, "Upon seeing the fluid, I instantly thought, fucking Monica, but that lipstick, no. Among White House women, fashion and especially lipstick were like trademarks. This wasn't Monica's lipstick. Someone else was entertaining the president late at night. As I testified in the Ken Starr investigation, I believe that this particular lipstick belonged to the current West Wing receptionist. I just knew it. I sighed, but I kept it to myself and didn't tell Nell or anyone else. I mentally filed that piece of knowledge under please forget." So, there was just a lot of this stuff going on. There's a case where Monica Lewinsky, after she was transferred to the Pentagon, tried to come back to the White House, and one of the Secret Service agents told her that the president was banging somebody else at the time. That's it. So I'm going to give this book, it's actually pretty good. It's Four Slick Willys. I'm giving a good review. I'll tell you why. This was a person who was subpoenaed for the Starr investigation. And he actually, the problem with being in the Secret Service is that you can't just testify to everything you see. And a lot of the things that he says in the book, it's probably even scrubbed for certain things that he saw that were not, he could not divulge. You know, and it's tough for anybody from the Clinton side to dispute. How are they supposed to come and say to us, you know, these Secret Service people are lying. The FBI people are lying. The Secret Service personal protective detail are lying. And then to expect, and then they're going to criticize people like Donald Trump for criticizing the CIA, and they're going to criticize, you know, Rand Paul for saying that our state is run amok and we're getting surveyed and whatever. Those things have to be put into context. The Clintons were the original group of people that basically screwed with our you know, our protective services, our Secret Service, our law enforcement and everything. They never were friends of theirs until they found ways to manipulate it. And instead of reducing their power and their enforcement abilities, the Clintons have just accommodated it, and they've gone and let it go out of control. And Gary Byrne just gives a lot of the firsthand stories of how chaotic the White House was under the Clintons, and how little accountability there was, and how he was basically being used as cover by the Clintons in order for Bill to get away with his affairs. And then later he was subpoenaed, and they were trying to make it seem like he didn't do his job right. Well, how could he do his job right if they were continuously forcing him to let this Monica Lewinsky through and whatever? The whole thing is that they try to blame Bill Clinton's issues on anybody but Bill Clinton. They try to blame Hillary Clinton's horrible personality on everybody else but her. And at some point, we just have to say enough. These people are accountable just like anybody else. We don't have to take their shit. And we ought to have a real truthful discussion of how they were as president and first lady. And every single account that I've been seeing until now, I am reading a couple of sympathetic, you know, books about them. But, you know, to be honest with you, they don't really say much. They don't say much about anything. You know, they don't say much about how the Clintons really functioned as president and first lady. All they are about how good friends they are with whoever. And I mean, I'm reading Webb Hubble's book right now. I have next to me this pile of crappy books, including four by the Clintons themselves. But, you know, how much do they really reveal? That's my question. The people who really reveal what was like under the Clintons are the people that worked under them. Stephanopoulos, Gary Byrne, Gary Aldrich. And Stephanopoulos himself isn't very truthful. He's known to twist the truth. That was his job as a Clinton spin doctor. I have also, what's his name? James Carville. I have Dick Morris. Dick Morris is considered to be the person who controlled the presidency for a while. Here I have a quote from Gary Byrne himself. Here he quotes George Stephanopoulos, who says, "Over the course of the first 9 months of 1995, no single person had more power over the president." George Stephanopoulos later concluded of Morris in his own book, All Too Human. Leon Panetta was quoted by Byrne saying, "Unbeknownst to me, Clinton had been secretly reaching out to political advisor Dick Morris in an attempt to take stock of the nation's politics. Clinton surely sensed that he didn't like Morris. He was right about that. So even though Morris started doing polling on the very issues the White House staff was working on, Clinton didn't share the results or even the facts of the polls with me. It was actually Hillary Clinton who had asked Morris to resume working for the president. The Clintons admired Morris, who openly disdained the substance of policy. He was about winning." So, you know, how many admissions do you have that the Clintons are just full of shit? You know, all they cared about was staying in office. They didn't care anything about actually running the country. Even their progressive base should know that under Hillary Clinton, under Bill Clinton, they traded in all of their political ideology for the sake of power. And that, therefore, none of their platitudes about, you know, helping the poor and, you know, tolerance and whatever, they're all crap. It's all a bunch of, it's all work. They just care about themselves. Anyway, so read Crisis of Character. I'm going to post a link and tell me what you think. Do you think that the Secret Service, their role was actually compromised under the Clintons? Do you think that we can have a president who actually redefines the security requirements of his office. Instead of the people that are actually supposed to be guarding him. Those are the real questions raised by Crisis of Character, and I encourage you to read the book a lot. I gave it 4 Slick Willys, and this is Ramon with Bold Like a Leopard, and we'll see you around the bend.